Hi there. As you know, the React Conf 2024 took place on May 15th to 16th. It's the only React conference I watch in full, and I must say, it's quite a feat. So, to make your life easier, I'll provide a brief overview of the talks, allowing you to choose only those that interest you. And of course, I'll include links to all the talks in the description. So, hit the like button, and let's dive in. I'll skip all the introductory speeches and move directly to the interesting moments and the content of the conference. The first interesting thing they shared is about creating cool applications using many different cool libraries. But there are so many of them now, and to simplify developers' lives, the React team has started recommending a simpler way to start a new application, namely using frameworks. On the next slide, they showed us their names. Personally, I perceive this news as the sunset of the React era, where React used to be just a small library. Now, learning React for new developers will start with some framework. Whether this is good or bad, only time will tell. The next interesting point they showed us is working with metadata. I skipped this point in the React 19 beta overview in favor of other more interesting features, but it's worth mentioning. Now, with React, we have the ability to pass page metadata directly from React without any additional libraries or homemade hacks. Next up was Andrew Clark, who briefly discussed the new feature, Actions, in my previous video, Testing React 19 Beta. I already covered this feature in detail, so be sure to check it out. Interestingly, Andrew mentioned that they were inspired by Remix for this feature. Now you know whom to thank or remember in your final moments. Andrew continued with a brief overview of changes to refs. All of this was also covered in my previous review. The only thing he emphasized was the phrase, "Never use forward ref again, because you won't need it anymore." Honestly, I've never used it myself. Write in the comments if you've used it, and most importantly, why. And Andrew concluded his speech by stating that React 19 beta is transitioning to React 19 RC status. In the coming weeks, a stable version will be available for general use. Congratulations to all of us on this. Next up are a series of speakers delving into the highly anticipated topic of the React compiler. First, Satya demonstrates a demo of a project before and after using the React compiler. It's just unbelievable. We don't need to worry about anything else. No more memo, use callback, or anything like that. It will all happen automatically. Just listen to the slogan, same code, faster by default. In other words, you don't need to change anything in your codebase. It will simply become faster. It turns out Facebook has been testing this compiler in production for over a year. Mofi Zhang shares a detailed story of the results they achieved, and let me tell you, they've accelerated initial loading and navigation speeds by a whopping 12%. Even a 1-2% speed boost is considered remarkable on such projects. These projects are developed by some of the most expensive engineers in the world, and here you have a 12% speed boost. I highly recommend listening to both presentations. They provide excellent illustrative examples. And of course, one thing worth mentioning, React Compiler is now open source and available for use, albeit in experimental mode. So be sure to try it out on your projects and share your impressions. The next presentation was by Ryan Florence, the creator of React Router. The talk was titled Vanilla React. He's a very charismatic guy with a great sense of humor, so it was enjoyable to watch him, but I didn't grasp the idea of the talk right away. He delved into a scenario where he has a massive single-page application project with an incredibly large code base. The project wants to use SSR, server components, and so on, but the team doesn't know how to proceed. Rewriting the entire code base in Next.js, Remix, or similar frameworks isn't feasible, as it won't be approved by the business. There's a need for a solution without significant rewrites. Towards the end, Ryan shares that there is such a solution, React Router version 7. He showcases a prototype where React Router is fully integrated with Vite. It seems to be installed as a plugin for Vite. Routes are defined directly in this plugin. After this setup, you can run your application as a SPA or SSR by simply toggling a flag in the Vite config. He also demonstrated how to work with server components when SSR is enabled. As you can see, everything works through loaders, and as you may have guessed, actions from React Router should work just as well as server actions, if you need them. What can we say here? It's become clear why abstractions like loaders and actions appeared in React Router version 6.4, and why there was a shift towards describing routes more actively as configs. It seems these features were introduced for an easier future migration to React Router version 7. But honestly, in my current company, we haven't migrated to version 6 yet. Therefore, the presentation is quite intriguing. I recommend watching it, and I'll definitely do a review when version 7 of the router is released. After lunch, Lydia Halley took the stage. She briefly went over all the new features in React 19. Let me list them. Firstly, they added the ability to pass an async function to start transition. Then she smoothly transitioned to the useActionState hook. I've already covered it in the previous video. There wasn't anything radically new there. Next up was useFormStatus. I didn't mention in my review that it provides access not only to the pending state, but also to all other data. Fourth was useOptimistic. I learned that apparently you can pass a second parameter to it. It's a function that, before assigning a value, suggests merging it with the previous value. It's convenient if you're storing an array and adding elements to it. Then came server components and server actions. I'll make separate videos about them, so let's not dwell on them. After those giants, there was use. Lydia pointed out that it's not a hook, but an API, and it's not subject to the limitations of hooks. I also covered it in the previous video, but one interesting thing she showed was a curious example. You can create a promise on the server and wait for it to finish on the client. Quite an intriguing combination. She does this so that server components don't block client rendering, but it seems there are already tools to avoid this, but apparently there are different situations. After that, some other features are mentioned, but we've already covered all of them in the previous video. Following Lydia, Sam Selikoff took the stage. His talk was about how a component was written in the old way, and now we're rewriting it using React 19 features. If you still don't fully understand how all these features work, you might want to take a look. And closing the pre-lunch lineup of presentations is Lauren Tan. She dives into what the React compiler turns our code into. For those who want to see the spaghetti code output directly, she shares the practices used under the hood. The main takeaway from this talk is that even if you write use memo, React compiler may still remove it and rewrite it better. So, there's no need to engage in optimizations. After lunch, the heavy artillery came in the form of Dan Abramov. His talk was about the origins of server components. He took a project without React at all, as written previously, and step by step, moved the logic from the client to the server. And he provided a good example of how the idea of server components came about. This image summarizes the entire presentation. I think studying this code will be enough for you to understand what the talk is about. Next up was Evan Bacon. His topic really surprised me. Server components in Expo Router. That is, he brought server components into React Native, and he showed demos of how well it works. Honestly, I didn't expect to see anything like that at all. But of course it was a prototype. And the router's author promised that this feature might not be available until 2025. This presentation got me thinking about a new trend. Already, the second router considers it its duty to start providing the possibility of a server router with all the accompanying features. It seems to be a new trend among router developers. Their main idea is that frameworks are not necessarily needed. Just use the router to its full potential. Such a future awaits us. That was the last major presentation. After that, there were short talks with various package ideas, discussions on why you shouldn't use hooks inside if conditions and so on. You can check the titles of these topics in the description and watch them yourself. And if you enjoyed my review, please give it a thumbs up and stay tuned for the review of the second day of the conference. Bye!